All right, welcome back to another video, which is a straight up follow up from the last one. So in the last video, we built this nav bar and we changed the background color to white and we kind of left the rest as is. The last video was getting a little long, so I wanted a little break, but we're gonna dive right back into it. I am also, this time I'm drinking a small bottle of white wine, so hopefully I can work on this while being a little bit while drinking. Turn my phone off. All right, so this is where we left off, and actually So one thing, I actually did this off screen, but the one thing I did before starting up this video is I made my first commit. So I actually want to explain this first. So I made a new branch called Part 1 Setting Up the App, and I made my first commit on that branch. And actually, you know, throughout this video series, every video I'm gonna have one or a few commits, but each video will have its separate branch, and that's the way I'm going to organize this repo, so that people who wanna clone the repo can follow along. So this is again the first branch, and actually right before starting, I tried to start up the app, and I found an issue. So I don't know why this was happening. This wasn't happening before, but it looks like the Rails app isn't compiling, and it could be that during this whole process, I had this binned up dev command running, and it didn't pick up the fact that I changed the app assets, style sheets, application.css to this scss file, and it didn't pick that up. But if I change this file to application.scss, I need to change my config. I believe it is app assets config manifest.js, this line right here. And the reason is this link directory, what it is, it's taking, I mean, at least the way I understand it, is it's taking this whole style sheets folder, and it's requiring everything in here, but it requires that the files be CSS. I want to use SAS in this app because it has more features than just normal CSS. So instead of doing that, to make this work, because right now it's looking at the entire styles sheets.css file, and then it's not finding the CSS file. So what I want to do is I want our manifest.js file to target specifically the application.scss. So instead of having link directory here, we'll have link. I actually found this answer in a Stack Overflow answer, and we want to change this to link application.css. So we'll do link application.css here. We're gonna delete this line, and then we are now going to reload, and you see that now everything is working again. All right, so I'm gonna make this part of part one. I'm gonna say this commit will be fix manifest.js, and since my first commit was in part one, what I want to do is I'm gonna delete my main branch and then check out to the main branch. So from now on, this will be the main branch because my first commit, it wasn't on the main branch, so it never really committed the main branch. This part one, setting up the app, became the main branch. So yeah, we are going to continue on this. And before I commit to finish this specific video, I'm going to branch off into something called part two, something, and then commit, and then end the video then. All right, so we are here, and comparing our little Airbnb with the real Airbnb, we are pretty close. One thing I want to mention is I'm not looking to make things look exactly alike. Close enough is good enough. And right now, it looks like the reason our padding is different from this and this is because it's probably that our max width is 7XL. I don't think Tailwind has, oh wow, it does have 8XL. It does have 8XLs, and I think it does look a little better. Actually, let's check out Tailwind CSS and see how far, to see how wide the width goes. So we'll check out width, max width, and it goes up to 7XL. So if we do width full here, it ends up being the same thing. And if we look here, this width is it based on a width or is it based on, I think it's based on a width. No, there's also some padding in here as well. Yeah, I think it's based on a little padding. Let's see. Margin left, margin right, and then there's some padding as well. And in our case, we have just the padding. So if we put something like margin left 2px, 2rem, margin right 2rem, it'll look more or less similar. But you know what, my goal isn't to, again, it's not to make everything look exactly the same. So what I'm, instead of putting this margin thing, what I'm gonna do is I'm going to put, I'm gonna increase our padding. So instead of having pixels padding X here, 8 here, I'm gonna make this 16 and see what that looks like. Maybe 16 doesn't work here, maybe 12. Okay, then maybe, maybe 8. Actually, before we continue, I want to look at how high does padding go. Padding. Looks like it goes up to, wow, it goes up to 20. Which is unexpected, but how come if I put padding 20 here doesn't work? It's because this is taking effect. So if we do 20, it's right here. PX20, MX auto. Well done. No, I gotta restart the server. Maybe 20 here. So I don't know why that's not working. That's super weird. If I make this 10, I don't know why that's not working, but regardless, the goal is not to make everything look exactly the same. So what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna keep it like this. And let's see what this looks like. Yeah, let's just continue like this. I think this is fine. Okay, anyways, this thing, what I wanna do is I want to get rid of this background color right here. Let's see, BG gray 700. And I think if we get rid of this BG gray 700 here, it'll look fine. So we are going to open up our editor and look for the search bar and then get rid of this background gray 700 and reload. And it looks like everything looks okay. And also it looks like when we hover, when we hover over the search bar, it hovers like the background color into gray. So Tailwind has this thing called hover listener. So what we do is we put hover and then into the class definition, and we do BG gray, maybe like, let's put it 700, right? And now if we do that, we hover over our search bar, it'll gray out the background. But the 700 looks a little bit too dark, so I'm gonna lower it to 200, hover over it, and this looks a little better. Okay, so one thing, I'm gonna do this to here as well, because it doesn't look good to this notification icon. So let's see. Right, I think the notification icon is, I don't really know where it is. Let's see. I think it is this one. And so instead of I'm gonna get rid of this background gray 800, save, and notice that it's gone now. So instead of getting rid of it entirely, I'm gonna put hover behind it and lower this to 200. And now if we hover over it, we get this background gray of 200, and when we hover over the icon. Okay, so to continue on with this, you can see that in our nav bar, we have this drop down here that really shouldn't be displaying when we load the page. Like, this should be hidden, and only when we click on our user icon here, this would show. So we're not using jQuery. Like, if you're using something like Bootstrap, these kind of features come built in, but I don't really know what the state of jQuery is these days, but it doesn't seem as widely used anymore. So these kind of interactions, we kind of have to build it on our own. And Tailwind UI, it doesn't unfortunately make this super easy. You have to build this yourself, but it still, you know, gives you instructions on how to do so. So for example, this is the component that we are using in Tailwind UI, and if we look at the code, like, okay, so this is the component, this is how it should work. You click on it and this thing pops up, right? So if we go to the code here, and we go to the open user menu, I believe this is the button, you can see that this part, your profile settings and sign out, that part is the drop down, but it should only show if we click on the button. And you can see that this is the transition that they want you to use, and actually this is Like these are like the CSS transitions, and like these are the CSS classes that Tailwind CSS comes out of the box. So you know when this dropdown enters the DOM, it should transition these out, and the duration should be 100, and it should come from these classes to this class, and when you're leaving, it's coming from this class to this class. Well, like, yeah. So I'm not super familiar with React or Vue. I should be familiar with Vue, but I'm not. But this stuff, I've heard that it's a lot easier to do in more feature set complete JavaScript frameworks like React, Vue.js, maybe even Angular. But in vanilla JavaScript, it's a little more difficult. And Tailwind doesn't give you a way to like easy instructions on how to do this. But thankfully, there is some guy who made this JavaScript library called transition. But let's see. Yeah, el transition. This is to be used with stimulus.js, which is the JavaScript library that we'll be using. Mostly because we want to stay true to the Rails-y way of doing things. So this is what we'll be using. Before we continue, what I want to do is I want to hook up a stimulus controller to our DOM, to our app. So I'm going to check out what's in our JavaScript folder. In the controllers folder, and it looks like we have three files here. I think this is Hello Controller is the sample controller that stimulus controller that Rails come with. I have no idea what this index.js is, and I also have no idea what this is. This is actually the first Rails 7 app that I'm building. So I'm gonna go open up the JavaScript folder controllers. Actually, I'm kind of curious what this is, application.js. Okay, and I'm going to open up the controllers, open up application.js. It looks like this is just starting up stimulus. And with that, I want to see what's in index.js. It looks like this is stimulus stuff as well. So now I'm going to open up Hello Controller, and this is just a dummy controller that we have, that Rails, I guess, makes. So if you look at this controller, it says import controller from Hotwire stimulus. Sorry, I'm a little anal about double and single quotes in JavaScript. It says when this stimulus controller connects, take the element that it's connected to and change the text content into hello world. So gonna open stimulus JS documentation, because I can never remember how to do these things off the top of my head. And the way you connect the controller is you get the div, and then you have this data controller, and then you put the controller name, and then the stimulus controller will fire its JavaScript and it'll do its magic. So all right, we're gonna go to test if our stimulus controller works. We are going to put a data controller hello right here, and then go back to our app. I'm gonna close my email client, reload, and it looks like. Yeah, it looks like it did what it's supposed to do. It connected, and it got the element that it was connected to, and it changed the text content into hello world. So if we change this to something like bi world, and reload our app, it'll say buy world. All right, so that worked. Now, I don't want to name this controller hello controller. I want this to be named something else. So I'm going to change this controller name into a header controller. I'm going to call this header controller. And, whoa, why is that empty? And in our header class or header HTML file, we're going to change this part to header. And now if we reload our page, it still does the same thing. And instead of changing the text content, I'm gonna comment this out so we still end up, we still have our header that doesn't get overwritten by some text content. And before we continue, we are going to install this L-transition JavaScript library. So we're going to look at the documentation for this before we install it. So if you look here, it says the purpose of this package is to handle enter leave transition using classes or data attributes. And this is very similar to the implementations you'll find in Vue.js and Alpine.js. I have no idea what Alpine.js is. There are so many like these different libraries. I'm just going to peek out what this is. Simple, lightweight. Yeah, I already lost interest. anyways, we are now, we're gonna go back to what the usage is like. And it says L transition support exports 3 async functions, enter leave toggle. And this is the same stuff that you'll find in the Tailwind UI. Transitions entering from to, leave from to. So, like when we enter, it looks like when we enter, we do certain things. When we close, we do certain things, and then you can also toggle, which calls enter or leave based on the presence of the class hidden. Which this class is built into Tailwind, so we don't have to add this class into our style sheets, and it looks like these JavaScript functions, enter, leave, and toggle, take these data attributes, data transition, enter, enter, start, enter, end, leave, start, leave, end, and does its transition magic, which these map very nicely to this instructions that we have in our Tailwind UI component. So this library is perfect for us. All right, so before we can use this, we'll have to install it. And since Rails 7, I think you can still use Webpacker, but I think the default way now is using import maps, which is, I wholeheartedly welcome that. I mean, I've always thought Webpack was a scam, now I actually don't remember how to install libraries and import maps, so we're gonna look this up. Maybe it's a manifest, or maybe it's in config folder and import map. And yeah, I don't really know how to install this, so I'm gonna Google Rails import map install npm libraries, and it looks like, yeah, I'm getting a little tired. All we have to do is run this command bin import map pin and the library, but jQuery is, hold on. So this is using npm packages via JavaScript CDNs. Okay, So maybe if I run bin import map pin, let's call L transition, right? If I run that, it should do its thing, and it grabbed the right URL to get the library, get the proper package, JavaScript package. So if we look at our import map RB, it got the L transition and it got it pinned to the right URL, but I'm actually wondering if this line has to come before the app JavaScript controllers folder, because we'll be using this inside our controller. So I'm kind of wondering if the order matters. The only way you can test it is actually trying it. It'll be nice if the ordering doesn't matter, but let's actually try this. So we'll go into our controller. We'll import these functions, and then in our connect, instead of changing our text content, we'll just console log out, enter. Leave, and also toggle here, and then we are going to go back to our app, open up our console, reload. My server isn't running. And it looks like it is indeed loaded. So this is great. It's perfect. Okay, so it looks like in import map, the ordering doesn't matter. Oh, you just have to end up just pinning things. So now we're gonna get rid of all these useless console log commands, and now in our profile dropdown. So this part, so there's two profile dropdowns. There's the one above and there's the one below. And the one below is the mobile menu, and the one above is the full desktop menu. So when we load our page, we would want this to be hidden to begin with. And when it's responsive, when it's responsive, we will want this to be hidden as well. I'm just kind of wondering why this looks so awkward. Just look at our nav bar here. And let's try minimizing this. And it looks awkward because the background color for this is supposed to be this navy blue thing. And we got rid of that background color, so that's why it looks awkward. But we can fix that later. It's not a big problem now. In regular Airbnb, it looks like there's no drop-down menu. Anyways, it looks like when you minimize it, the top bar, it goes away, and you get the menu at the bottom, which is different. Not really sure if I want to take into account that would be a lot of work, but we'll see. We'll see how far we go. Okay, anyways, I'm gonna take care of this one first, the non-responsive, the non-mobile menu first, And the way we do that is we will, which one is the non-mobile one? We will hide this first, which is your profile settings, sign out. And when we reload, this thing goes away. And what we want is when we click on this, who is this? It looks like Tim Cook. When we click this, we want the menu to show up. Now, to do that, we want to give the button the header target of user menu, open user menu. Yeah, we'll make this camel case. We'll give it the target name of open user menu, and in our stimulus controller we'll have we'll define our static targets, and we'll target open user menu here. And we'll have to open our transition again, and we will copy all of these data transition tags, and we will start adding it here. So I'm organizing this so that it's easier to read, and we will add all of the data transitions here. And these transitions, we are going to copy it from our template. So it looks like when we're entering, we want to copy the transition ease out duration 100. Oh, wow, it looks like this is pretty much the same. So, scale 100, transition ease in, transform. Okay, cool, it's already done for us. And then we will say, I have no idea. Okay. So we have to, it looks like we have to add an event listener to our little button so that when it's clicked, and then we pass in the drop-down menu, which it looks like you can't make it into a target because this is gonna be a private, just regular JavaScript function. And for whatever reason, stimulus targets don't get picked up in private functions. So maybe there's a way to do it, but I'm not like a stimulus.js expert. I've just used it in a few apps, and I find it to be useful. And I like it. Basecamp makes great things. So what I'm gonna do is I will, in our headers controller, I'll say this open user menu target, which is actually targeting this button right here. And I'll say add event listener, and we'll add a click listener, and we'll pass in a function that will get fired when it gets clicked. So we'll call this function toggle drop down menu, and we'll call this toggle drop down menu, And in here, we want to toggle the actual the drop down that should display and disappear. So we'll say, hey, document the get element by ID, and we're gonna be targeting this div. So we'll give this an ID of, I don't know what to call this. Menu dropdown items, and paste that in, save the file, go back to our app, reload, and it looks like we get a JavaScript error called toggle dropdown menu is not defined. Maybe it needs to be this toggle dropdown menu. Yeah, that's it. Now, if we click our menu here, you can see that this, our little beautiful menu pops open, and it also goes away. So that is how the dropdown works. And I could continue and make it work here, but the reason I'm not going to do that is because in the regular Airbnb, it looks like it doesn't have a dropdown menu anyways. So I want to get rid of that and maybe do a footer instead. I'm actually like pretty amazed how long these video sessions are for, just to get a navigation working. But regardless, it looks like now we have this little beautiful drop down working. So I think this is a pretty good point to end the video. So I'm gonna end it here and also make the commit. So before I end it, so I'm going to go back to our editor or our terminal and create a new branch. And I'm gonna call this part two. And let's name this header nav menu dropdown. Gonna add everything, and I'm gonna make this part two. Add header nav menu with dropdown transition. All right, so this is gonna be for this video. I think for the next one, what I'm gonna do is, I think I'm going to make this footer. I'm gonna make this footer that shows up when we minimize the screen. So hopefully these videos are entertaining and more interesting than the small little Rails videos before. So thanks for watching, and hopefully y'all stay in tune for the next one.